Welcome in, everyone, to another episode of Dahm. That's true. I'm your host, Owen Domination 7, and joining me is a very special guest, Alison underscore Renner, known for her K-State Twitter fame. Alison, how are you doing today?
I'm good. How's it going?
Chilling. Glad you could make it. You're really coming in clutch here for us. Truman is in Florida with his lovely girlfriend, doing things with her family, so he can't make it in today. So called an audible. I was ready to do a solo episode, but I was like, wait. Allison's tweeted at me like 4 times saying that she wanted to be on the show at some point. So here we go. Here's your opportunity. Okay, so we're going to be talking Chiefs-Bengals. We're going to be talking NFL as a whole. I also want to touch over the Sunflower Showdown coming up tomorrow. I'm going to kill this music so I don't have to listen to it anymore as I'm speaking. Then we're also going to talk about maybe a little bit of Gene Taylor, maybe some hot Twitter takes. And finally, our top 5 fitting for this episode and for today, which is the 30th of January after the AFC Championship game. Top 5 frustrating officiating moments in our fandom. It could be any sport. I've got a couple. Yeah. Okay. So, Allison, why don't you just talk about your Twitter account a little bit and the work that you've done on in the K-State community? Because I know you recently got shouted out by @BigGameBoomer as the number one K-State sports follow.
Just my personal Twitter account, and I think the past couple sports season cycles, it's kind of, I've just kind of gained a mass. But if you look back, you know, the last 10 years or so I've had a Twitter, I mostly just tweet about following sports. I think that Twitter's a really good community for that. So, and then past couple of years, I've really noticed how big the K-State Twitter community is on there. So it's been fun just meeting different people and kind of reconnecting with people from college when I was there, or, you know, meeting up with people at games and stuff. And Twitter came out with this communities thing, and I thought that, you know, K-State Twitter would be a really good candidate for having its own community on there. So I've kind of tried to gather up everybody in that space, and that's been good. We've gotten a lot of, you know, people trading tickets in there, people trading merch and whatnot, and yeah, it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, I know that I've personally definitely gotten someone to take my ticket from there when I couldn't make a game. It was very clutch. I think what we need to do to get it to really pop off is just tweet at it's the two guys that are, they don't like each other very much, but they're huge. I think it's like KSU fan 14 and K-State man. If we can get those, because they host like K-State after dark, right? Like the Twitter spaces, right? After victories, if we can get those guys to use the community, I think we could get it to pop off. But I mean, we'll see.
Fairly peaceful so far, but...
Yeah, exactly. It's been, you know, mainly people said, oh, you know, and it always pops off during game days. So, all right. Let's get right into it as I check to make sure my stream is up. It is. Okay, and the intermission's been on this whole time for our... for the viewers, so let me kill everything else, but so they can actually see our lovely faces. Where's the text box? That right there. Boom. This is just wonderful. You can tell I am so good at this streaming thing as I adjust things on the fly. Okay, there we go. All right, so let's get right into it. Chiefs versus Bengals. Obviously, you are a big Kansas City fan like me and has experienced a lot of Chiefs games in our lifetime. That was definitely one of the AFC Championship games of all time. I know that I was sweating bullets the whole time. I was talking with one of my Boston friends, and he was saying we were going to beat the Bengals by 20 after we kicked those 2 field goals. And I said, listen, man, I don't care what the score is. I'm not relaxing until the score is 0-0. I mean, until the clock hits 0-0. Obviously, it ended up being a very close and, frankly, very scary game. Just tell me about some of your emotions going through that game.
There's a lot. I don't think I ever really felt confident until the last couple seconds.
Yeah.
As soon as the Bengals beat the Bills, I was just like, well, it's nice that we get to play Arrowhead, but I would so much rather play the Bills because I know we could beat the Bills.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what we actually said. Me and Truman agreed on that on the pod. We both said that we would have much rather play the Bills because, you know, the Bengals, for whatever reason, I never thought that in any of the times they've beaten us that we've been, like, that much inferior. It's not like, you know, when the Chiefs had Alex Smith, you know, and we meet Tom Brady in the AFC Championship game. It's like, well, dude, I just, you know, I hope we win, but you never really felt like it was a hope, right? Like, you never really thought going into that game, we were super confident, like, we were the better team, we're going to beat the Patriots. Going into all these games against the Bengals, I did feel like we were a better team, but the Bengals just seemed to have that it factor. And I'm going to be honest, when Mahomes, like, did that weird-ass fumble in the third quarter, I was like, here it comes. Here comes the Bengals.
Just stop working.
Yes, it's gonna happen again. So I'm glad we finally got over the hump. I have a couple Bengals fans, friends. They felt like, you know, they had the game and just gave it to us. I know that
they were,
I felt like,
insanely confident going into it too.
Right.
To be fair, I wasn't feeling very confident for the same reasons. You know, the Bengals have figured out how to build a team to beat the Chiefs the same way that the Raiders and the Chargers have been trying to do for years.
Right.
And they got it. So that's what made me nervous.
Yeah, here, let me pull up a stat here that I thought was pretty interesting. I thought it was weird that just the lack of running from the Bengals yesterday. Did you feel like they just kind of abandoned the run game too early? I mean, they had like 71 total rushing yards. Did that feel like a strange game plan to you?
I guess I didn't really notice it as much watching until at the end when Joe Burrow started making some of those just saving throws.
Right.
But to a point, it was also kind of working. You know, they'd get third and long and then hit a guy 20 yards out. So, yeah, they probably could have benefited a little bit more, but up until the end, it was kind of working out for them.
Right.
I don't know. I think I was just so nervous the whole time, worried about our offense not being able to get anything going for pretty much the entire third quarter.
Right. So, if I told you that in this season, in the regular season, when the Bengals beat us, they rushed for 152 yards, and yesterday they only rushed for 71. Would you have believed me?
Yeah, that is crazy.
So yeah, going into this game, Truman and me, and then our friend from Cincinnati, Logan, Hannah Learns to Read on Twitch, by the way. Give him a follow, he's a good guy. But he was saying that, you know, the Bengals need to run the ball. They need to get 150 rushing yards. And they've had that the last three victories against the Chiefs. They've had over 150 rushing yards. And, you know, the Chiefs being second to last in run defense, I was expecting a lot more rushing, even when the Bengals were down. But for some reason, running game just wasn't working for them today, and they kind of abandoned it. I think that kind of ended up to them losing the game. I think that if the Chiefs have less time on the clock, that the Bengals, that's a very winnable game for the Bengals. But let's get into this. I know that Twitter is very upset about the officiating. I think it needs to be taken with a grain of salt because it seems like everyone on Twitter is from the ages of 15 to 18. So, you know, it's a lot of kids with fake profile pictures, you know, talking about officiating. They don't know ball. But I want to get your thoughts. What do you think about the refs?
Specifically in, you know, the Chiefs Bengals game, I thought it was all right. I mean, it wasn't a perfectly called game, but I do think it was fair on both sides. There was that one play clock mishap, which, you know, yeah, you could complain about that because that was kind of shitty. It was still, in the end, fair. They did show the replays and show that they tried to stop the play, but, you know, you can't really be having that happen at the NFL level. It's not a flow hoops college basketball game type of situation. So, yeah, if there's one thing to complain about, you could do that. But honestly, the individual penalties and everything, or what they called versus what they didn't call, it was pretty even.
Right.
It wasn't the worst thing I've ever seen.
Right. And, you know, obviously I'm looking through Chiefs tinted glasses here. But personally, I think calls that they might have messed up on did benefit the Chiefs. But the thing is that those calls didn't end up mattering in the game, right? So the 3rd and 9 redo. So the Chiefs, you know, on that first 3rd and 9, threw an incomplete pass. And so 4th and 9, I'm going to be punting, I believe it was from our own 40, I think. or from our own 35, right? And so that, you know, they wave off the play, referees running on the field say, hey, you know, we need to restart the clock. It's still third down. And the Chiefs convert. I just don't understand why people are forgetting that after that we just threw three straight incompletions to waste, you know, 25 seconds, and then we punted. So no scoring was done on that drive. Who cares about third and nine?
Then the next. I honestly haven't seen too much complaining about that one because that drive ended up not mattering at all.
Did you see Jamar Chase's tweet? He tweeted about, he said three third and nine question mark, and that was all he tweeted. So players on the Bengals are bad. Don't know why you choose that one.
Yeah, I've seen mostly fans complain about a missed hold during Sky Moore's return, his last return.
Yeah,
went out to the 50-yard line.
Have you seen that replay?
Yes, I've seen it. It's not going to get called.
I didn't think so either.
No.
You know, on runners like that, you know, you got him faced up, you're looking straight at him, and he's trying to get by, and you're pulling and you're pulling. It's not one of those ones that gets called very much. And then there was a block in the back maybe on that same run back that they were talking about. Once again, ones that super far away from the play. It's going to be tough for the referee to see. I can understand complaints about that. But the Chiefs, you know, had a timeout in 50 seconds. I picked the Chiefs to go that distance anyway.
Right. I mean, even if they were to call either the hold or the block in the back, Chiefs would have got it on the 8-yard line. They're saying, oh, no way they'd make it down that far, but did everyone forget about the Bills game last year?
Right, yeah.
Yes, they can absolutely go that far. So, in the end, I don't think any of the calls or officiating affected the outcome of the game.
Right, and then I think the one that, for some reason, Bengals fans aren't complaining as much about is the intentional grounding. Because I know that live, it looked awful. It looked like obvious intentional grounding. But when they show the replay, you know, he's got that running back that's around 5 yards away. A lot of times they let quarterbacks get away with that one. In this case, they didn't. But the Bengals also converted. That was on their touchdown drive. They got the third and 19. So I don't. Once again, these calls that everyone really should be focusing on that were more bad calls, you know, for the Bengals, it ended up not mattering at all. So you know, I think the officiating was fine. It's not anything normal. This is just something that we saw, you know, last year. I mean, 2 years ago when the Chiefs beat the Bills. You know, the Chiefs aren't allowed good success. It has to be, you know, rigging the NFL. So, you know, we got to change the rules now. Referees have to be full-time officials. Overtime has to be both teams get the ball. People don't want to see the Chiefs, which I don't understand. I think it's just because the media love to talk about Patrick Mahomes. So, and I guess it's, you know, I reached out to one of my Patriots fan friend and was talking to him about this. He's like, is this what it was like when Tom Brady was the best quarterback in the NFL? Because I was thinking about how I acted. And as a Chiefs fan back then, and I think it must be pretty similar because, you know, people talk about, oh, you know, Tom Brady, you know, that stupid roughing the passer call that Chiefs fans will never forget about. The Chiefs still got three more third downs after that, third and longs. So, yes, that drive got extended by that penalty, but you also had three chances to get off the field. And I just think that's one more thing that you think about, like, you know, once you graduate college and become a real adult and you start understanding ball more, it's like, come on, man. Just get off the field.
Yep, agreed.
All right. So what do you think was the – so enough about the referees. I don't want to talk about them anymore. It's exhausting. It's stupid. I promise you Chiefs fans don't care. We're going to the AFC – I mean, we're going to the Super Bowl. You guys talk –
I mean, my team won, so.
Right. The Bengals fans talk so much shit. I've been typing weep, seethe, and cope on Twitter. Like, not like last night, just typing it nonstop. I was laying into these people. I think I still have some bookmarks to look at on my Twitter. That might be Bengals fans or people that I have one that there was a dude that said the Chiefs aren't going to make the playoffs. So I really need to slam him.
Not Eli Apple and the Mayor of Cincinnati, just all of them.
Yeah, Eli Apple's got it. He's getting smacked again, just like he got smacked after the Super Bowl on Twitter. Okay. What do you think was the biggest play last night?
So it might not be the biggest play for everybody else, but for me, the play that turned the game around for me to give me hope that we were going to win, because I thought if that game went into overtime, we were not going to pull through. We were so banged up and so tired. I didn't think we had it in us. But when we got that interception on the Bengals' last out, I don't remember who caught the interception. Joe Burrow was third and long, threw it downfield. We ended up getting it around the 20.
Yeah, that was oh my gosh, Cook. The guy, well, not Cook, Bush, Deion Bush, the guy that we got from the Bears that mistakenly tweeted, "What's up, Chiefs Kingdom?" when Tyreek left. And they were like, "Not now,
Deion." That's right.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
He tipped it.
Even
and then
better.
Yeah, and then I believe Joshua Williams is the one that came up with the interception.
Yes, yeah, that for me was like, okay, we might actually be able to pull this out and, you know, avoid overtime. That was a huge play that I think turned the momentum of the game around.
Oh, absolutely.
And even though, you know, some people were saying, well, maybe we should have let him punt because we might have gotten it, like, a little bit closer. But, no, I think when you have turnovers like that, that are interceptions, fumbles, I'd rather take a couple yards back and then gain the crowd, gain the momentum back. So
right.
That's the play that gave me life again.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's a really good point. I was also thinking, well, maybe we should have just swatted it. But I think we have to remember that wide receiver, I don't remember if it was, I think it was T. Higgins, made a crazy play to tackle him there, actually. To have the awareness to watch the tip, see the catch, and then still tackle him. That was pretty incredible ball awareness. Yeah, I think I might go that. I also liked Watson's interception. Just the quick turn and pick was a pretty incredible play. I'll just have to go Butker's kick. I mean, to win it, come on. That's a little bit of a cop-out answer. All right. So now I want you to quickly pick the MVP of the Chiefs offense last night, because I think there's a lot of good choices. And the MVP of the Chiefs defense last night, because I know I have mine too.
So if we're going offense, there are a lot of good choices. There are a lot of really good plays made. The name that has really stuck out to me all season, though, being consistent, is Pacheco. He's just been such a surprise this year and so fun to watch. And as a K-State fan, I see so much, you know, parallel between him and Deuce Vaughn. Just the way that he can get up the middle with his size and being patient enough to wait for the gaps. You know, he'll take what should be 2 or 3 yards and make it a 10-yard run. And
absolutely.
He's been a ton of fun to watch for me, and I really enjoyed him watching him against the Bengals team yesterday. And, yeah, I think he had a good time with it.
Absolutely. Yeah, so for my offensive player of the game, I got to go MVS. He had over 100 yards and a touchdown out of nowhere. He was, you know.
That's true.
And I don't know if you saw the video on Twitter of his reaction of him just smiling that he's going to go to a Super Bowl, like almost in disbelief.
If you haven't,
you should either go on Twitter or Google it. But he's kind of like, you know, sitting there crouched down. Then I'll go to the Super Bowl! Like, you know, it's one of those things where you just smile for a guy that's, you know, been underutilized, didn't really work out in Green Bay, and had a decently mediocre regular season, but has been huge for us in the playoffs. So you just have to love something like that.
Yeah. No, I love seeing somebody step up like that, too. Especially when you're the Chiefs offense and you're so deep, typically. Mm-hmm. Seeing somebody that can just come up out of nowhere, you know, and fill in for Hardman, fill in for, you know, wherever he's needed. That was really fun to watch.
Right. And so who do you choose for your defensive player of the game for the Chiefs?
I might be biased because he's one of my favorite players, but almost always, if I'm picking a defensive player, it's Chris Jones.
Yeah.
I every time he gets a sack, I always tweet out, like, feed this man. Like, he's just so clutch all the time. He didn't even get, the first couple sacks, but eventually got one in there.
Right, yeah. So
he's just a monster.
Yeah, Chris Jones, monster 2-sack game, had that sack near the end of the fourth quarter to force that Bengals punt, on which the Chiefs eventually scored the game-winning field goal. Did you know that he actually hadn't had a postseason sack until yesterday?
Yeah, that was just a crazy stat because, you know, he gets a sack almost every game.
Right.
Yeah, no, and that was always kind of an ongoing bit, almost as like, will he ever get it, you know, this game.
Right.
And finally got his sack, and everybody was pretty excited about it. So.
Right, I mean, I believe he let me make sure that I have this right. I believe he led the league in sacks this year. Let's see here. Seasons. Sacks. Oh, no. NFL season 2022 sack leader. Oh, Nick Bosa with 15 and a half. I think Chris Jones at 15. Whatever, man.
He's up towards the top there.
Yeah, whatever. Chris Jones was a monster this season. I'm glad he finally got those two sacks. But yeah, those were huge. Real quick before we move on to the well, we can spend some more time on it. But okay, so as Chiefs fans well know, the special teams has been really frustrating for us this year. Personally, I think that's what lost us the Bengals game. The first time around, we did not have good special teams. Missed a couple. Left a couple points laying on the field. But this game, special teams were great. Tommy Townsend boomed, I believe, all of his punts inside the 20. A couple inside the 10. Then no missed extra points, no missed field goals, and decent punt returning, especially with that really big punt return from Sky Moore after Chris Jones forced that really big sack. So my question to you is, are Sky Moore and Butker forgiven after this recent playoff game, or what are your thoughts?
Starting with Sky Moore, I was definitely not very impressed with him throughout the season. I felt like every time we're watching a Chiefs game, my friends are texting me, like, cut Sky Moore, fire him immediately. Right. Like, this is every single game, it was something, he did something wrong. Even if he would redeem himself, like, kind of throughout the game, but I have to remind myself a lot, too. He is a sixth-round rookie. I mean, he'll figure it out, you know. We get drops. Tyreek Hill dropped that kickoff against the Texans, and we went down 21-0. Although I felt like his drops were excessive this season, that last return at the end was huge, and we needed that. So he did come in clutch where it really counted. So I'm hoping to see him develop more and get more confident in that position next year. I don't think Andy Reid's going to give up on him. I think that we're going to see him return another season. I hope he's going to get better. But, you know, we'll see about it. Again, I have to remind myself, okay, he's a rookie. He's not Tyreek Hill.
Right.
Even Tyreek Hill made mistakes. Harrison Butker, also very surprised because he's been such a clutch dude. I think that he not only got a lot of flack this season because he was making stuff he should have, but also just some of the off the field stuff too. I think people were just annoyed with him.
Yeah. The COVID off the field comments, stuff
aside. Yeah, but I mean, you know, off the field stuff aside, it's just like, yeah, you need to be making those extra points. Those are free points that could cost us the game in the end. And I don't remember if they did cost us the game in any, at least cost us to win out instead of overtime maybe. But I think that he's been, in the playoffs so far, he's been all right. I still don't fully trust him, but watching Dallas blow away so many.
Yeah.
Which made me feel better about it, at least. Right. So maybe he just put that, like, all those vibes onto Dallas's kicker. I don't know, but
right.
So far, he's all right. If he can, you know, stay perfect through the playoffs, if he can get through us through this season, not have any major screw-ups, I think everyone will be pretty quick to forgive him.
Right.
But, you know, maybe it's just one of those off years for him. I don't know, but, you know, we just haven't seen that before.
Right. So here, I'll tell you this. So Harrison Butker in the postseason, 47 of 50 on extra points, and he's only missed two field goals in the postseason. So in 2018, he had two, made two. 2019, had two, made two. 2020, had eight, made seven. These are all field goals, by the way. 2021, had five, made four. And this year, he's perfect as well. So great postseason player. He's had a rough regular season, but pretty historically, you know, right where you need your postseason kicker to be. But yeah, off-field stuff besides, you know, he's got some kind of weird opinions about vaccinations, in my opinion. But then again, this isn't a political podcast. This is a sports podcast, so we don't care about stuff like that. But yeah, in my opinion, I think Butker's been great this postseason. I think they've worked out. I think there's been miscommunication in between Butker and Townsend. I think that a lot of those kicks, well, not all of them, but some of them have certainly been on Tommy Townsend and him not having that perfect flow together. Special teamers notoriously just, you know, especially those skill position players like kicker and holder, they don't really practice all that much, man. Like, what are you going to do, kick 400 balls in a practice? I don't think so. So,
you know, it really surprised me that Tommy Townsend's a captain for the playoffs. I just didn't really expect him because you don't typically have your punter out there as a captain.
Right, but he's been a beast. So
good. He's very good. So I think it's well-deserved. It just, yeah, just kind of took me by surprise when they released those pictures.
Yeah, I always find it funny about captains. A lot of times they just, you know, they'll choose special teamers and or like, you know, like gunners and like people like, I think Marcus Kemp was a captain at some point. But, you know, just guys that you never really see play. How much, what were we looking at for time? We're doing pretty good. Real quick, I want to get into it. Do you think that this pseudo bye week, I guess, is going to be super important for the Chiefs? I know that, you know, we saw Willie Gay go down. We saw Juju Smith-Schuster go down. We saw McColl enter the game and then go back down. We saw Kadarius Toney might have picked up something. Obviously, no news yet on any of these guys. But how important do you think these injuries are going to be for the Chiefs going forward?
It's hard to gauge just because I don't think we know like the full exactly what those injuries are. If mm-hmm. you know, something as minor as a cramp or, you know, pulling something, those 2 weeks are really going to help. If it's anything more than that, maybe putting some rest will give us a little help, but those guys aren't going to be back 100%.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's going to be a net positive for the Chiefs because we had so many injuries in that last game.
Yeah.
However, I always do get worried when we have bye weeks, and this goes for any team, college teams, NFL teams. There's something about bye weeks that, although, you know, coaches, players will say, oh, we're not slack and we're practicing just as hard, getting those extra reps in when you're playing a lighter game or something like that is so much more beneficial than, you know, taking a whole week off. So these guys are professionals. I trust them to it, but it's just, you know, I've seen the Chiefs go after a bye week, oh, come back fully rested, coming in, and then just get beat because they weren't ready for it.
So. Yeah. Yeah, I will tell you that the last time the Chiefs had a fully functioning O-line, we won the Super Bowl. Also, obviously had that 2 week break, so maybe ease some nerves there. But, but yeah, so I think it's obviously going to be good. Travis Kelce was, you know, kind of a weird game time kind of thing. He was just having some back spasms, but if he was spasming on the field, he was going to play last night. We're talking about Travis Kelce here. And now entering the Kelce Bowl, I expect him to be fully ready. Mahomes is made of adrenaline, rubber bands, and whatever alien DNA they have in him. So I think Mahomes will, you know, be like 90%. You know, he heals faster than anybody in the world because it's Mahomes.
All right. I need to get a hold of his athletic trainer because I don't know what magic she worked for that.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Did you see the AI retouched picture that the one person did? Because the picture that they posted of her was really grainy. Someone went in with an AI and scrubbed it up to make it easier to look. Yeah, it's like, yeah, you know, want to redo her picture so she can look better. Yeah, it was pretty fun.
Oh.
All right, so moving on from the AFC Championship game, obviously big win for the Chiefs, narrative wise, and obviously, you know, you have to win to move on to the Super Bowl, but do you think that the Eagles are a bad matchup for the Chiefs, good matchup for the Chiefs? I want to hear your thoughts. Because personally, I think that it's kind of an Occam's razor, double-edged sword kind of situation. Because I think that while the Eagles, you know, run heavy team going against a poor run defense, I think that you have to be able to throw to beat the Chiefs. And I don't think that the Eagles can. You know, we're talking about a team, you know, they didn't have to against the Niners at all, but you should have more than 93 passing yards entering the 8-minute mark of the third quarter. If I tell you right now that they have 93 yards entering the third quarter, I'm saying Chiefs up 14, because I think even if the Chiefs are struggle against the run, I think that's a lot of that's because we face good quarterbacks and you get players like Samaje Perine for the Bengals, who I expected to see a lot more of, are just able to run on a light box because they're defending the pass because they're scared of these wide receivers. I don't think the Eagles have the guys that can scare the Chiefs that much. And I think that we're going to be able to go into heavier sets and really control this Eagles team, who really hasn't played a tough team all year. I mean, not all year, but in the playoffs. Well, honestly, all year. They really haven't played that tough of a schedule, but also in the playoffs have really played nobody so far.
Yeah, I mean, I've definitely not been following the NFC as much. If I'm watching games, I'm watching a Cowboys game just for fun, or just watching specific storylines.
Sure.
Or good matchups. I think that the Eagles are a good team. I think that they're a talented team. But the gap between the NFC and the AFC is so much bigger.
Mm-hmm.
I would equate them. I don't think that we're huge underdogs in this situation, per se. Even though, you know, the Eagles have the best record in the NFL. They've been a dominating team all season. I still think that, you know, we will be a good matchup for them because of what you were just explaining with the not being able to get those huge yards on big throws. I guess they might just try to run it the whole time. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I think that we'll be okay. Mm-hmm. They do worry me a little bit. I guess I wouldn't be super ashamed if we lost to this Eagles team.
Sure.
Like I said, I do think they have talent. I think they're good.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't paid enough attention to them during the regular season to really judge.
Yeah. You know, I've been watching them. One of my coworkers is a big Eagles fan, so I've been using this week. I told him, watching to work today, I said, hey, we're not friends for the next 2 weeks. Fuck you. And he, of course, laughed. Now we're good friends. But to me, this Eagles team seems a lot like the Ravens teams that we've been seeing. But I think Jalen Hurts is a worse thrower than Lamar. And, you know, this happens every year to the Chiefs. We come against a run-heavy team with a run-focused coach, run-focused O-line, and a good defense. And that's the Ravens blueprint, right? That generally hasn't been able to beat the Chiefs. So, you know, because you try to run the ball, you try to take the ball away from Patrick Mahomes, which is theoretically a good idea, but that means you have to win every time. And that allows for zero times where Chris Jones blows up your play. That allows for zero times when Nick Bolton makes a good play. And that accounts for you have to have a weak and injured Willie Gay. Now, Willie Gay is going to come back for the Super Bowl, and he's going to be a gigantic factor this game. If Willie Gay has a good game, the Chiefs can very easily win this. But I think with Hurts being a worse passer than Lamar is, I think it's going to come down to the Chiefs versus the Eagles defense, which I believe is like number one in almost every category. So I think that's where the real matchup is. I think the Chiefs have a real chance, and we finally don't have to play a home Super Bowl. So that's also very, very exciting. Yeah, do you have any more comments on the Chiefs or anything you want to talk about before we move on to our next segment?
No, I don't think so. I don't think I'm super worried about the game. I think it'll be a good game. I hope it's a good game. I guess that first Super Bowl win nerves are kind of off of me. So even when we lost that second year against the Buccaneers, it didn't sting too bad. And, you know, just hoping to have fun with it.
Sure. I was definitely way more pissed than you. I was so mad. I turned that thing off in the third quarter. I heard my family cheering for a couple of plays Mahomes made, but I said I don't care. I was so angry. I turned that game off, went and played video games, and drank a whole bunch of beer. I was not very thrilled about that. All right. But, yeah. Oh, do you have a score prediction? Because we always do score predictions for the preview. So, oh, and I also, sorry, before we do score prediction, I can't believe I forgot this. I want you to give your keys to the game for the Chiefs and if the Chiefs will win, if kind of thing.
You know, I'm actually not too worried about our defense. I think our defense will be able to hold them. I think we can keep up. I am worried about getting, you know, aligned on offense and getting our vibes right for our offense to score points, because we've gone through long droughts of not scoring touchdowns, especially. The vibes all just need to be right. The connection between, you know, Mahomes and Kelce, Mahomes and Pacheco, whoever it needs to be to step up, or multiple people to step up to score us points.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. So give me a Chiefs win if.
Chiefs win if we can get a couple scores early, run the clock most of the game.
Awesome. For me, Chiefs win if Isaiah Pacheco has over 110 rushing yards. Because if the Chiefs are running the ball that well, that means we've been able to hang in with them on defense, and that our O-line's doing their job, and that means Patrick Mahomes at least 250 yards passing. So for me, Chiefs, Isaiah Pacheco over 110 rushing yards sounds like a Chiefs win to me. All right, so now moving on. So actually, this is one of the first times we ever actually had a full segment for this kind of thing. But because you're on the pod, I figured we might as well do it. So I wrote this down. We're going to be talking cats for one of the first times ever on the show. Obviously, you were born and raised a K-State fan, correct?
Yep, both my parents went to K-State, met at K-State, and my brother and I went to K-State, so everything K-State.
There you go. I'll say this quietly. I actually grew up a KU fan because my mom taught at KU Med, but by the time I wanted to actually watch sports, that was freshman year of college. So, and it didn't take me any time at all to completely forget about KU. And, when I first went to college, my parents were like, hey, you know, we kind of been cheering for KU for a while. I don't know if we're going to be able to, you know, fully, you know, hate KU. It took them 2 months of talking to KU fans about me going to K-State for them to say, nah, we're not doing anything KU anymore. So,
the full transition.
Yes, it was not very... The KU fans often make it pretty easy. Sorry, KU fans that are listening to this. I still love you. You guys are still my friends. Obviously, you guys are all right. But a couple people twisted my parents wrong, so that's not on me. That's not on you guys. All right, so I want to talk Sunflower Showdown. The Cats open up as a 6-point underdog in Allen Fieldhouse. Obviously, the Cats have historically struggled to win in Allen Fieldhouse. Bill Self, you know, turned that place into a freaking fortress. They almost never lose. Yes. Oh, and real quick, in the chat, one of my KU friends actually said that Chiefs win if they win the turnover battle. Completely agree. But going into Allen Fieldhouse here, Bill Self, Fortress, K-State generally not winning too many games. You know, a couple very close ones in recent memory, especially when you and me were at K-State. But generally speaking, Bill Self doesn't like to lose too many games in a row. They snapped a three-game losing streak. Would have been four had they lost, but they beat Kentucky, really controlled the paint, which is scary because I think that's where K-State kind of struggles. So let's see here. But Sunflower Showdown coming up tomorrow. How are you feeling?
Maybe less confident than I was a couple weeks ago, but all of my feelings are based on how KU has been performing.
Mm-hmm.
If KU would have won their last three games after they beat K-State, I'd still have 100% confidence in K-State, which makes no sense at all. I just can't bet against Bill Self losing that many games.
Right.
Which is a horrible way to bet on things, but it makes me nervous if his team starts falling apart, because at any moment he's gonna snap them all back together and all of a sudden they're gonna be a totally different team.
Right. Yeah.
I think that they will make a lot of adjustments from when we saw them in Bramlage. But this is also it's not the same KU team it was last year. They've lost a lot of talent. They have a lot of new talent coming in that I think will, you know, get better as they're in college longer. They're only starting 5 stars Grady Dick, which everyone thought was going to the NBA after. I don't think he is after these last couple of performances. They are a beatable team. They've been a beatable team all season, so I'm hoping you pull it out, but yeah, being in Allen Fieldhouse is a huge disadvantage too.
Absolutely. Speaking of home cooking, we all know refereeing decisions there. That's one that I fucking forgot. Oh my gosh.
How did you forget?
Yeah, I gotta put that. Oh man. Okay, I gotta replace some things on my list here. But yeah, Grady Dick, you know, turns out not a direct replacement for Christian Brown. And that's, you know, that's been a cause of a lot of their shortfalls. You know, he's been shooting like less than 30% from three, which is, as much as I hate to say it, probably not going to last the whole season. And I hope, you know, K-State isn't his get-right game, but Jerome Tang's defense has notoriously been very solid. You know, we've got a lot of key contributors on defenses here like Cam Carter, Tyke Green. Desi Sills, been in a little bit of a slump, 1 point over his last three games, but has been a very solid contributor as the sixth man on defense. And Most importantly, David Gasson is getting healthy, and he can dominate in the paint. And that's where I think KU has to attack. If David Gasson isn't on the field, they have to go after Ejiola. But Ejiola is not anywhere near as weak as these K-State centers have been over the last 5 years. He can actually catch, and he can actually shoot. So that is, you know, different from the last 4 years of K-State centers. You know, we always felt like these guys had bricks for hands and just absolutely couldn't do anything with the catch and shoot game. But Ejiola has shown he's been able to be a very good contributor for this K-State team. Oh, but it's Allen Fieldhouse, man.
I don't know. I mean, you saw who TCU did it. That game absolutely shocked me.
Mm-hmm.
But TCU can do it.
Yeah, I think TCU is this year's Iowa State. They have all this potential, and they just randomly pop off and randomly lay eggs. And then Iowa State's just doing Iowa State things. Can't win on the road. What is going on with that team? So strange. They played their Super Bowl against Kansas State, apparently. Got out all of their shooting against us, you know, and continue to have no away wins. Like, it's honestly just bizarre. Yeah, but what do you think about Tang? Obviously, K-State fans love him so far. He's been wabashing with the students at their home wins. Got the FKU chant out of there real quick. Been very adamant about that. I don't have enough words to say how good I'm feeling about Jerome Tang right now.
Yeah, no, he's been the best K-State hire that we've seen immediate results from,
mm-hmm.
I think, ever. I mean, yeah, obviously, Bill Snyder, Coach Kleiman's great, but we've never seen immediate turnaround. He had nothing to work with. He built this entire team himself,
mm-hmm.
by recruiting starting in, what, April?
Yeah.
Like, in spring? Yeah, no, I can't say enough good things about him. I was a little bit worried because he's been so focused on... It's not a bad thing. He's been so focused on the students and the culture around K-State basketball from a student and spectator perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I was a little bit worried that was going to creep into the gameplay a little bit. Especially at the beginning of the... K-State KU game in Bramlage,
mm-hmm.
students start chanting, you know, the FKU chant, and they zoom in on him, like, on the side of the court, just shaking his head. I'm like, okay, dude, if you're focused on what the students are yelling and not this game that's in front of you, we're gonna be in trouble. But didn't seem to, you know, affected the end, and he keeps winning.
Right.
It's hard to be mad at him when he keeps winning.
Yeah, I don't remember a coach in my time cheering for Kansas State, you know, for the last 10 years. That has, well, not 10, 8 for me, which is, I hate that I just said that out loud. That feels like way too much time. But that has been, spent that much time on campus. You know, he's got that that chat with Tang segment that he does every week where he just goes on campus and sits with a microphone next to him and just chats with K-State students. I don't remember seeing a coach with just, you know, this amount of love for our university. You know, you never saw Bruce Weber. And, you know, Bruce Weber is always struggling with recruiting. And that's what actually something that I want to get into real quick. You know, starting this season, 10 cleared house, right? Only two guys left on the roster that Tang wanted to stay or wanted to stay in general. I mean, we saw Nigel Pack leave. You know, admittedly, if I'm Nigel Pack, I'm taking that money too. That's $800,000.
Oh, for sure.
I don't blame him. But the NIL Joel jokes are hilarious, and I stand by that. But, so, Ish Masood and Marquise Noel, only ones on the roster left. So, you have to find around 8 guys. And, you know, he pulls the likes of Ejiola, Gasson, Sills, Green. Just a solid group of guys. Cam Carter, especially, has been huge for us. And Naquan Tomlin. He pulled these guys out of, like, community colleges and, you know, Desi Sills and... And Cam Carter was like some of these guys were like 1 point per game players last year. And he's just turning them into all Big 12 players. I mean, and, you know, Desi Sills has had a rough patch these last couple games, but put up 24 against KU. Just it's just incredible. You know, I was told you can't recruit to Manhattan. But, and he, you know, he had a 5-star in for a visit. He's had several 4-stars. I mean, just an incredible turnaround. And Yeah. Whew.
I think the other part of Tang too is it's very different as a K-State fan to see your coach be so active online, because we've never had a coach that's runs its own, you know, his own Twitter account. I know that Bill Snyder runs his own Twitter account, but he only, you know, gets on there every 6 months to wish somebody a happy birthday. So.
Yeah, or say that Sean had a good game.
That too. Or, you know, break some really personal announcement.
Oh, but. I still can't believe people are clowning him. He's like 80. And, you know, so he's in the connection. So obviously somebody told him. He was like, you know, hey, really hate to hear this. Be like, he hasn't died yet, Bill. It's like, well, listen, dude. Yeah. You think he's just hearing through the grapevine? No, he's heard from somebody probably in his family that this happened. Right? We're talking about Coach Snyder here. He writes letters to players. So
yeah. But it's so fun to see that different. And don't get me wrong, Chris Kleiman is never online, and I don't think he runs his own Twitter account. But I wouldn't have it any other way. Chris Kleiman is that type of guy who's very just professional, straight up, only cares about what's happening on the field.
Right.
I think with basketball, it's different. Football, you always have that traditional coach mentality of, okay, this is it, unless you're fucking Lane Kiffin, and then you start all this off drama, and I don't want any part of that.
Right.
Basketball's always been more of a, you know, look at the NBA. It's all about the player drama and getting to know, you know, the coaches and the staff and whatnot. So I think that having a coach be very online and very interactive with the fans and with the students is perfect for basketball. So I've really liked that side of him too.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's that too. I mean, we saw his, you know, introductory press conference, and you're just like, wow, you know, this guy's got a lot of energy. What a great press conference. And, of course, we, you know, got clowned, you know, KU got a national championship and K-State got a good press conference. It's like, ah. You know, honestly, that was pretty funny from KU fans. Shout out to you guys. Yeah, that is pretty funny. You know, you win the national championship while, you know, your rival is in dead last in the Big 12. All right, fair enough. Fair play to you guys. But, I mean, who could have expected this coming out? You know, K-State on top of the Big 12 standings right now, technically still tied with Iowa State. But has the best record in the Big 12, controls our own destiny the rest of the way. To winning a Big 12 title out of nowhere. So, you know, shout out to Coach Tang and what he's done. It's been completely incredible. You know, like we talked about with the students and his outreach, it's super strange. It doesn't feel right for him to be as active as he is. I mean, obviously none of it's been negative. It's all been good stuff. But I'm not used to my coach retweeting people and doing stuff other than retweeting, you know, the official K-State men's basketball Twitter. So you know, I guess I have to give a shout out to my friend Punished Caleb. He was a huge Bruce hater, and he always said that you know, surely we can find somebody who does a better job. And the argument always was, oh well, who are you grabbing, you know, what high profile coach are we bringing here? And then, you know, Gene Taylor finds Coach Tang, 19 years an assistant coach, K-State head coach, and he's going to have a winning season in his first season. And the ceiling is just huge for K-State sports right now. We're really high up.
There's no ceiling. That's the best part of this all, is that I had zero expectations going in. My only hope was we didn't get last in the Big 12. Definitely not getting last.
Right, definitely not.
I don't know, maybe first? Who knows? Maybe we go far in the tournament? I can't be upset with this team. We could lose. I mean, if we lost out the rest of the season, I'd be kind of upset.
No, that would suck.
There's not much that this team could do to make me upset at them, just because of how well they've just completely turned around, and they keep getting better because they're getting more and more time playing with each other and practicing with each other, so...
Yeah, just an incredible job by Coach Tang, grabbing 8 guys that weren't on the team last year and getting them to tie for first place in the Big 12 right now. I mean, don't hang any banners yet. I mean, obviously a lot of time left, a lot of games we still have to execute, especially with this one coming tomorrow. Really going to be a thermometer. You know, we can honestly, I have us losing tomorrow. It's going to be a close game. KU always performs well in Allen. But, you know, so I'm not, you know, going into this game, oh, we're going to smack KU around. It's a winnable game for sure. But it's not. It's definitely not the end of the world should we lose. I mean, it's freaking Allen Fieldhouse. They just don't lose there. So, you know, getting a win there would be huge. But the sky's the limit for this K-State team, especially with how poorly Baylor and KU have started out this season. You know, if I told you at the beginning of this year, Allison, that all we had to you know, to look forward to for our real threats, for challenging for the title, are TCU and Iowa State, you taking that?
No. For last, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. So, just goes to show how much can change in a few short months. But yeah, so I want you to pick real quick your way too early K-State men's basketball player of the year, because I know who I'm choosing. I think there's two real choices.
Well, exactly. It's either Marquise or Keontae. You can't really go wrong with either of them. I lean towards Marquise Noel just because he has been the entire story of this K-State basketball team. He has been so integral with creating the team culture from scratch. Maybe not helping select these players, but really, you know, he had an input on hiring Tang
yes.
with Gene. So this man runs the basketball team, but at the same time, you wouldn't know that because he's just such a team player, and he's so just all about K-State. So I'm going with Marquise.
I completely agree. I think Keontae is a really attractive choice. I think this game K-State goes as far as Keontae and Marquise are willing to carry it. I mean, this team isn't, you know, lost without production. I mean, we saw that game against Texas Tech, where, you know, it took a while for Keontae and Marquise to heat up, and then you get guys like Cam Carter and Naquan Tomlin pitching in heavy points. Saw that especially the other day with, you know, Marquise not starting out so hot and Cam Carter exploding out of nowhere against Iowa State. Still ended up losing, but to be in a game without your top scorers going crazy just tells you leaps and bounds about it. And then, of course, the game against Florida where, you know, Marquise just took over that game. He almost had a double-double in the first half. I don't think he ended up getting that triple-double because he ended up playing fewer minutes in that second half. K-State had a pretty heavy lead. But Marquise Noel is the absolute glue. He's shooting logo threes. You know, one of the first players in my memory that pulls up for a logo three, and you're like, okay. Like, you know, you're not the most upset ever. Like, because half of them go in. And then his passing and court vision is just crazy. Obviously, with a young player, you know, he's bound to have a couple bad passes that get turned over. But his turnover to assist ratio is just mountains. I think he has a chance to break the K-State assist record for a season this year and definitely cement himself as one of the greatest K-State point guards of all time. But, I mean, once again, just a hell of a player. I do think it's funny on that text where it was showing that he had input on the coaching hire, because he sends that big long message, hey Gene, I want to be here, I love K-State, I want to be here, check out this coach from NC State. And then, you know, and Gene's like, yeah bud, thanks. And then the next message is, get Tang, and Gene just responds to him with a thumbs up. That's so funny to me. They didn't need to include him trying to recruit Middle Tennessee State.
Oh,
the MTSU guy. He's like, they didn't need to include that in the image that they show, but
that was
still
pretty funny though.
No, it was hilarious. But and this just in. So you might not know this, but we are famously bad at knowing exact stats and saying completely wrong things. And my chat has just told me that he's actually only 13 away from their school record in a season.
Yeah, well, they've been talking about it all season, so I figured he had to be pretty dang close.
Yeah, I didn't realize he was that close.
No, I didn't either.
Yeah, so Marquise Noel is definitely going to go down as one of my favorite Kansas State players of all time. All right, I want to give you a hypothetical, okay? So, K-State is notoriously terrible in the postseason, both basketball and football, when we win a conference championship.
That's true.
So I'm going to give you a hypothetical here. So, yeah, by the way, over the last 8 years – well, going back actually to 2012, when the basketball or football has won, they have won zero postseason games after that.
Yep.
Yeah, which is crazy to think. That's so weird. But I'll give you this hypothetical. Would you rather K-State win the Big 12 in basketball and lose their game against what's projected to be a 14 or 15 seed? Or narrowly miss out on a conference championship, but make a Final Four? What would you rather have?
When you put it like Final Four, that's tough. I would almost always say conference championship because whenever you're going back trying to pull out stats to show off to somebody, you always can pull conference championships. That conference championships, and I know with basketball it's a little different with the tournament, but that's what
Oh,
you're hanging your hat
not
for, right?
counting the tournament berth, not counting that. Just regular season conference championship, raise the trophy.
Right. I like the conference championships. I think it'd be really cool to do it, in football and basketball and have such a good year when K-State wasn't projected to really be the top at either. I think that'd be pretty cool. I kind of go back to, what was it, 2019 when we won that conference championship
That
and
was awesome.
then immediately lost the next game to Akron.
No. The Anteaters. The Anteaters. I don't.
I know. Who are they? I know that they're the Anteaters, though, because we played them earlier that it was either the year before or earlier that season,
UC Irvine.
in Branch, Irvine. So I mean,
Terrible
I so
map.
I was in Italy when we were playing that game, and time difference was crazy. It was like 9 a.m. and I was looking at the score and I was like, eh. I don't think I was that mad because I was, on vacation. But the conference championship, being a student there, being so involved in that, I'd choose conference championship, but I've never seen a Final Four.
That's true.
I don't know.
Personally, I mean, we made the Elite Eight also when we were in school in 2018. I know people always love making it to a Final Four, but for me, I've never, I get that, teams always talk about how many Final Fours they've been to. You do hang a banner for making it that far. You do cut the nets. There's a lot of cool memorabilia that comes with that. But it's not a championship to me. I would much rather win a conference championship than make the Final Four, personally. I know that might be a controversial opinion. I know that my chat is, they're all saying Final Four, so much better. I like conference championships more. I think it, like you
I like
said,
the title.
especially in the Big
I want
12,
a title.
which is the best basketball conference. Oh, and that's another thing that I want to talk about. How is Alabama only dropping two spots after getting destroyed by one of the number eight team in the Big 12? How is.
I honestly think that the AP voters, they just don't know what to do with the Big 12 because we already have what, half the Big 12 in the top 15. It's like
Right.
they just don't know what to do because we're all going to start beating each other, and we have started beating each other. Even though the Big 12 has the best teams, it's not working out the same way that the SEC does in football, and they just don't know where to place everybody.
Yeah, I also don't think the AP voters watch the games. There's no reason that Alabama's dropping two spots after getting destroyed on the road by an unranked team. Think about it this way. If K-State's ranked number two in football and you lose to unranked let's see here, let's get a unranked Vanderbilt. They're dropping 10, 15 spots, maybe even all the way out altogether. But I don't know where Alabama's getting this credit for that they can go to number four. It looked like they didn't even get off the plane against Oklahoma. They played so bad the whole game. I mean, I guess you could say that Oklahoma played really good because they shot like 70%. But that goes on your defense. I don't know. But yeah, for me, I'm taking the conference championship all day, personally. I love, the Final Four. It's great. But I think that finally, as a K-State basketball fan, we can look up to legitimately contending for national titles. It's very early in Tang's career. Maybe he just got lucky with this roster here. We got lightning in a bottle. But I'm gonna be optimistic. I think that Tang has a real chance to build something actually good. Also, please, Gene, pull out those strings for him. He's gonna get try to get sniped. Carl and
He's
Mary
gonna get a
Ice.
keep him first.
Yeah, exactly. Carl and Mary Ice, I know you got those big bucks. It's time. This is the one that we need. Get those NIL money in there. But yeah, then there's also reports that Keontae turned down like five, it was like a couple mil to play at K-State.
Really?
He turned down like very serious money. to play at Kansas State University, which is wild.
Well,
but,
you
which
know,
is
and
just...
I realized from last weekend with his interview, he's really trying to get to the NBA. I think he's much more thinking bigger picture and what team is going to get me eyes to the NBA scouts rather than, you know, I don't know, another team that's maybe willing to pay him some, but maybe not take a full risk on him
Right.
and showing his full abilities.
And I think that's just a compliment to the Big 12. I mean, because he chose the best basketball conference to play in. I think he was looking at the Big 12 because the Big 12 has the best teams. Big 12 has the last two national champions. And the year before the Baylor won it, Texas Tech was in the national championship game. So I think he's looking up the competition. He's in SEC, you know, okay, two good teams. He's looking at Pac-12. Any good teams? No one really knows. And then the ACC is just a bunch of crap teams with top-heavy Duke and North Carolina. So...
both kind of having down years this year too.
Yeah, exactly. But yes, we are going to have this episode on Spotify this week. It'll still be going up on Wednesday like normal. But yeah, I think Keontae is just choosing Kansas State because I think he saw the writing on the wall that the rest of us as fans saw, that the Big 12 is going to be really, really good this year. And if he does well in this Big 12, that scouts going to be like, "Yep, you NBA." And I just still can't believe that nobody wanted to take a chance on him. Can't believe Florida gave him up. Real quick, as we finish up our K-State segment here, did you see the handshakes at the end of the K-State-Florida game?
I did. So I didn't actually get to watch the full game. It was poker night, so
sure.
I was catching glimpses. But I saw the video afterwards of Keontae going through the Florida line, and it made him feel nice. It was good.
Right, yeah. Super cool that he, you know, him and the other players do remember all their handshakes. That was, you know. I think basketball more and more every year, I think in the NBA more than college, it's becoming more of like what baseball is now, where there's not too many heated rivalries. Of course, there's always going to be guys that hate each other. You know, sports is a competitive environment, but more and more it's becoming like a brotherhood of dudes that all like the same sport and are all trying to get to that next level together. So, I mean, just a really cool moment for a guy that's been through so much. Obviously, the media is going to, you know, keep talking about that as much as they can all year because it is a special story. But you do love to see things like that. All right. You did say Marquise Noel as your way too early player of the year.
He's my pick.
Yeah, all right. All right. We always like to touch on betting a little bit. So I'm going to go ahead and read off K-State championship odds, and then we're going to have a look at the Chiefs odds for the Super Bowl here real quick, and we're going to talk on Boston Butts. Are you a sports bettor at all yourself?
So I'll follow what the lines are for each game, but I'm honestly just too lazy to download the app. I just haven't set up an account.
Well,
I've gotten this far, so.
Right. Also, the thing is, if you didn't, you know, get that free money in the beginning,
yep.
It's like, you know, why don't I just... do anything else with my dollars, you know? Let me see here if I can get things about Kansas State in the Big 12 futures here. I know that I got I actually got Kansas State plus 20,000 to win the conference when the betting lines first opened up on the first day, and I put $10 on it. So if the K-State ends up winning the conference, I get $2,000.
That's
so
impressive.
Yeah, it's gonna be. I'm really hoping they pull it out because that's an immediate trip to England for me. So,
that'll be fun.
Yeah, that's okay. So the Chiefs, K-State opens up as some money has been coming in on KU actually. I know the line opened up at K-State plus 6. Now it's up to K-State plus 6.5. Do you think that's a bettable line? I know you said you're familiar with sports betting. Do you know how lines work exactly?
Yeah. So
okay, cool.
I think it's doable. Like I said, we can win. We could beat KU. We could definitely get close within 6 points, but I'm so worried. I am super superstitious when it comes to basketball, and if I like go all in on something, like I can just never fully commit to an outcome. But
okay.
If I'm being reasonable, yeah, I would take K-State on that to cover.
I think I am actually gonna bet that right now. I like that. I think money's gonna come in on K-State as the week comes in. I
think that
think
line will get a lot tighter.
there's two scenarios. It doesn't stay at 6.5. No way. I think it gets maybe plus 5.5. Either goes plus 5.5 or it keeps going, or money keeps coming in on KU. If a news story comes out that Bill Self said, our team just isn't as talented as it used to be, that's nightmare scenario, actually. That's when K-State fans need to start getting worried, because Bill Self does that every year, and then his team just beats the crap out of somebody at home. So I hope he hasn't said anything too negative about his players. I don't think that Christian, I mean, Christian Brown, sorry, Grady Dick's struggles that he's had this so far this year are going to keep continuing. But I also don't think that Desi Sills is going to be in the rut that he's been in. And the Cats have still won two out of those three games with Desi Sills in that little rut that he's had. So, do you have a score prediction?
I would just probably pretty close to what it was at Bramlage. I mean, I think originally to the game in Bramlage, I said it was going to be like 78-76, somewhere around that. I think that we stay within 3 points if I were to pick right now. I hate that I'm saying this out loud because I'm, like I said, I'm super superstitious. That's why I don't sports bet, because if I have money
Well,
on
hey,
something, then
if you have superstition against it, and that means there's a reason for it. So if you don't want to say your score to jinx it, you don't have to.
I think we stay within three, and I think it'll be somewhere in the 70s, 80s range.
All right. So I'll tell you this. If Desi Sills has 10 or more points, I think the Cavs can pull out a like 78-76. If Desi Sills has less than 10 points, I think we're looking at a 78-73 KU victory. I think these margins are that fine, that we need these sixth man players to be the best sixth man on the court. But so that's where I'm putting it. Desi Sills over 10 points, I'm thinking we're looking at a K-State close win. Desi Sills under 10 points, I think we're looking at a K-State close loss, unfortunately. But once again, as I said earlier, nothing to be ashamed of losing KU on the road. With how popular basketball is at KU, and rightfully so, kids are already camping out. Are you aware of how the camping policy works for KU? Has
No,
anyone ever
not
told you?
really.
So
No.
here's how it works. In the student section, anyway, seats are first come, first serve. Camping starts a week before the game, and you and your friends, you have to register with their ticket office, how many seats your party is holding, and then someone has to stay in line the entire week. At all times, 24 hours. Or you lose your
That's
spot in
definitely a
line.
bonding moment.
So, but the thing is that, if me, you, Ozzy, Brandon, a couple other guys say, hey, we're tailgating, we're camping for this game, only one of us has to be in line at a time. So, I mean, these KU fans, you can't say they're not dedicated. They love their sport. And yeah, camping started just today. So.
Oh man. I definitely appreciate how K-State does it. As a former student who could not skip out on classes, and I do appreciate that they reward students for going to games earlier in the season, so that we're not having to do that. Especially in January, it's so cold.
Hey man, they're serious, dude. They're crazy over there. So I think we can one day reach that level of commitment. Yeah, it's gonna take a little bit. We're talking about KU here. As much as I hate to give them props, they invented basketball. So they probably should have had more national championships as good as they've been over these last 20 years, especially. Oh, by the way, I want to talk about that real quick. Bill Self has squandered more number one overall seeds than any coach in NCAA history, by the way, just so you know.
Really?
His average finishing place with a number one overall seed is 10th, which is bad. So if you have the number one overall seed, if you're the best team going into the postseason, you're telling me you don't even get to the Elite Eight. But yeah, so in case he's looking at plus 6.5. Talk to Chiefs betting line real quick, then we'll go to top five, get out of here. Thank you so much for coming in and filling in, by the way. You've done excellent. Have you done a podcast thing before?
Not one with video, so.
Okay, I was gonna say,
Nor
surely you've
have
done this
seen
before. You've been great. I was not expecting, most time we have people in on the podcast, even people that have done streams before, and they're just not ready for a, kind of back and forth conversation like on a podcast. So we're very impressed. Thank you. You've done brilliantly. All right. So by the way, on MGM, because of advertising rules, the big game is what the line is on. It opens up at Chiefs plus two today. I think I'm taking Chiefs plus two.
Yeah,
Are
for sure.
you? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I think that we'll see money probably come in on the Eagles as more injury news comes out. It all depends on injury news, but I think max this gets is Eagles minus three. I think there's no way it gets anywhere less than that.
Now, I don't see the Chiefs releasing any injury information saying that people absolutely will be ruled out. So I only
Right.
see that line getting further away with the Chiefs.
Absolutely. Looks like they got. I use MGM because in the beginning of the year, when MGM gave out 200 free dollars, right? That was actually four $50 free bets. So you had to bet all that $50 at once because they're betting you don't, cash on most of those bets. I ended up
Right.
only hitting on one of those four bets, but the one I did hit on was a Jody Fortson anytime touchdown score versus the Cardinals. So I won 325 bucks off of that. And that is the only reason that I use MGM because that's where most of my free money is.
It is.
So, looking at the boost that MGM has, conscious of time, it's like a Jalen Hurts anytime touchdown score and Travis Kelce anytime touchdown score with the over being at 50 and a half is plus 425. I think that's great value there.
I don't get too heavy in the parlays. Those get away from me.
Well, yeah, what they say is that you really,
That's how you make your money, though.
well, kind of. From what I've heard and what I've seen, Truman's dad is a professional sports handicapper. And I can actually kind of say this from my own experience because I've been losing money with my parlays. But if you, I've been told by a lot of guys that if you really want to make money in sports betting, you build your parlay and then you don't actually bet the parlay. You just bet those individual things to happen.
Ah,
Yeah.
that's a good idea.
And you use your same unit. And that's worked out well for me. There's a segment that I have called Owen's 5-Team Parlay. So every week I choose five NFL teams I think is going to win. I think I've won. I've actually picked all five teams correctly once. But I think I've only gone 2-3 or worse twice throughout the year. So I've been going like 3-2 or 4-1. And so all those weeks that I went 4-1, if I would have simply picked individual teams, I'm plus money. So, but yeah, so that's my advice. Try to break up your bets if you're going to sports bet. Or do what Allison does, which is not bet at all. That is probably the best way. People always say, if you're betting $10 on this parlay, you might as well just wipe your ass with $10. It's a better way to spend that $10 bill. So,
Hey, but people said that about betting K-State to win the basketball championship.
yes, it's not gonna hit over, so it's not over yet. But if I do win
Never
two,
stop betting.
that's right. They say that 99.9% of gamblers quit right when they're about to hit
Even
it
before they win.
big. But in all reality, as we always say, if you do have a gambling addiction or know someone who has a gambling addiction or someone in your family is affected by a gambling addiction, the gambling hotline is 1-800-GAMBLER. So, all right, let's wrap this thing up. Real quick, how's Gene Taylor doing? You like what he's doing so far?
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I think that, home run hire with Coach Kleiman, home run hire and a half with Coach Tang. The only hire I think he's really missed on was his first, which is for baseball. I don't follow K-State baseball super close, but they're not having any super crazy success. I actually think they were bottom of the conference the past couple years. I could also be totally wrong, but I think we'll see if he can keep the streak going with the volleyball.
I'm also
He
interested in
just,
that.
I don't follow volleyball as closely as I did when I was in school, but this coach, his resume, it seems pretty good. He's coming from a pretty stacked Pac-12 school, so I don't know. I think I'll follow him a little bit closer next season and see how things go and see if Gene Taylor keeps the streak. Even if he doesn't, he's still a great athletics director. I really love what
Right.
he's been doing the past couple
Yeah,
years.
I completely agree with what you said. Two home run hires. And on both of those, actually, I'll fully admit, I did not like the Tang hire. I wanted Neil Brown, who ended up going to West Virginia, and we know how that went. So I think
Climbing, not tank.
no, yeah, sorry. No, you, no, I
Neil
wanted
Brown.
so no, I wanted Neil Brown that went to West
Yep.
Virginia. And what did I say we hired Tang?
You said you didn't want tank.
Oh, I didn't want him either.
True. Also true.
I was so I think Gene Taylor's done a great job of showing me that I don't know shit about hiring people at a sports level. Because, obviously we didn't know Tang was on the market as fans. We were like, oh, grab that middle Tennessee guy, the guy that made John Morant so good. Blah blah blah. And then, wanted Venables at OU. We see how that's going. Wanted Neil Brown at West Virginia. It looks like he's gonna get fired with 18 mil on his contract left. And I was like, gosh, this nepotism hiring from his old place, this is gonna be terrible. And boom, Big 12 championship, recruited guys like Deuce Vaughn. Okay. Sorry, Gene. I'll shut up. I already apologized to you on Twitter. That's my bad. But yeah, I think he's done a great job. Really looking forward to this volleyball coach. And I actually want to try to go to some volleyball games because I think, the Morgan Athletic Center, we need to start calling it the morgue to fit like the kind of doom, the Octagon of Doom.
You.
But yeah, but calling it the morgue, that's just sick. That's a sick nickname. So,
That is pretty cool.
but looking. It's just hard to keep track of. Unfortunately, K-State baseball, K-State volleyball, it just doesn't have the media availability that basketball and football have. But I do follow them on social media. I will be watching their career with great interest as we go forward. Okay, let's wrap this thing up. We had a good, a little bit over an hour, looking like a good episode here. Let's get into our top fives. And real quick, Allison. Where can we see more of your lovely content and wonderful Twitter takes?
My handle is at Allison underscore Renner. Just my name.
Any other socials that you have to plug here, or just
No.
Twitter? Just
Don't
Twitter.
follow me on Instagram. Don't friend me on Facebook. Just Twitter.
All right, so.
Everything else is private. Twitter is free range. That's fine.
Gotcha. Okay. So yeah, all our Chinese listeners, ni hao to you guys, by the way. We have like 30% of our listeners actually from China. We did our Spotify metrics. Very funny. But
Oh, cool.
so Twitter's out there, unfortunately. No Instagram, no Facebook for obvious reasons, guys. So go follow her on Twitter. She's a great Twitter follow. Once again, recently voted best K-State Twitter user to follow, by Big Gay Boomer, notoriously good list maker, of course. So Allison, let's get right into it. What are your top five most frustrating sports ref situations outcomes that you've experienced?
Are we starting from number five or number one?
Yeah, number five to number one, and then any honorable mentions that you have first.
Okay, can we trade off a little bit because I know I'm forgetting some, but I'm going to
Sure.
start with
Here,
five.
I can go first if you'd like.
Okay, you go ahead and go first.
Sweet. Okay, so honorable mention to a very specific. I don't know if you watch Premier League soccer at all, Allison. Not a whole bunch of my friends do. They're big football fans. But there was a specific offside this year in the Champions League with Harry Kane versus Sporting Lisbon, where he was off by an armpit, which was just fucking drove me insane. But the inconsistency with VAR in general can go in my honorable mention spot. Another one in my honorable mention is the K-State double kick decision on the onside kick versus OU. I guess, guys, I understand. It was the right call. He did double kick it. But we can't allow a third review, surely, right? I understand they got it right. They reviewed it, he challenged. They reviewed it once. Stay with K-State. He challenged, lost the challenge, and then he bitched and got the call? Come on. So that
The
goes in my honorable mention.
inconsistency there.
So number five is the last year's Ja'Marr Chase OPI that ended up losing the Chiefs the game. It was a very clear push off, shoved him to the ground. he had full control over his body, suddenly off balance. And then Ja'Marr Chase is, you know, making a spectacular catch. Yeah, Charvarius Ward wasn't falling down randomly. So that goes to my number five. You know, whatever, Cincy fans. You know, I'm sorry. I can't think of too many things that were super, you know, that were more obvious. You know, obviously, that's one of those ones where the Chiefs didn't lose the game because of that play. It ended up being a play that ended up, you know, moving the chains for them so that the Bengals did end up winning. But I couldn't think of too many super quick. So that I'll probably remember some as we go and remove that one off there. Number four. Allison, I'm sure as a Chiefs fan, you remember this one. That stupid fucking holding call against Eric Fisher in the divisional round against Pittsburgh in 2016, where Alex Smith threw that game, would have been game-winning touchdown, and they called Fisher for a hold that was just fucking awful. Just an awful call. I remember being so pissed because we ended up losing a game where the other team didn't score a touchdown and kicked six field goals. Just made me sick. Number three. I gotta change my number two and my number three. Number three, that roughing the passer call against Tom Brady. I talked about it with you before the pod, but Chris Jones slapping a shoulder pad is roughing the passer. That was awful. You know, obviously that was in the AFC Championship game 2018. Chiefs would go on to lose that game. And then that was on a third down and nine where the Chiefs picked off the ball on that play. Was called back. Obviously, that's not the whole reason why the Chiefs lost. You know, we're fans of sports. Calls aren't going to go our way all the time. But I remember being very upset about that one. You know, obviously, Tom Brady got three more third down conversions. Julian Edelman, of all people, was carving us up. But listen, I was pissed, and that's why it's on my list. Number two, Zvi's 28-step travel. I mean, how can we forget that as K-State fans? I was screaming my fool head off at my house with my mom. And, you know, growing up, I had a problem where I yelled at sports way too much. And this was one of the few times, actually, where they saw the play and my parents didn't stop me from yelling at the TV. Because it was so fucking bad. I was so pissed. And then, actually, it's what inspired my tweets against Jaguars fans the other day and against Cincy fans. I remember seeing this one KU fan tweet, "Hey, man, it was a perfect game. K-State fans got something to complain about, and KU won." And that just pissed me off. But now I realize that was just an epic troll tweet. That was just like a very, very good sports troll tweet. So I've been repackaging that and using it for myself. And I used it against KU fans when Ishmael showed that picture where you can't tell if Ishmael's back is down, but like, he's clearly down.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so I used that against KU fans, and that felt good just to use their own words. If I really wanted to go back and try to find the Twitter, because I remember it being this girl that tweeted it. I don't remember her name, but I wanted to try to find her Twitter and tweet at her about it specifically. But that was a bit petty for me. I would have to do a long list of research for that. And my number one sports controversy ref moment. I'll never get over this. Hold on. Let me see if I can find something real quick. I'll be right back. Hold on. It'll only take me a couple seconds. But this is a play that pissed me off to no end. With this jersey, my favorite Chief of all time, Derek Johnson. That fucking stupid forward progress on a fumble. Are you shitting my dick? You remember that against Tennessee? You remember that play?
Yeah. That was
Derek Johnson flying up the middle, completely unblocked, slams Marcus Mariota in the chest, knocks him on his ass. He's fumbling. The Chiefs are on it. Forward progress on the play. Second down. What?
Those are the worst, too. It's not just like, oh, bad calls or what. It's when a penalty ruins such a good moment like that.
Mm-hmm.
That was a weak call. It's just...
Well, it's not a rule. There's no forward progress on a fumble. That's just not a thing. Once you blow, it's not like he was like his knee was down. He got trucked. He got trucked with a clean hit and fumbled.
He wasn't even trying to pass yet.
Exactly. He just got. Oh, I was still mad about that. Of course, as Bengals fans would never know about the Chiefs. We actually are a pretty tortured fan base. That was in 2018. Holy shit, that pissed me off. I'll never forget that, especially because Derek Johnson's like my favorite Chief of all time. But yeah, I'll run you back through the list. Once again, honorable mention to Harry Kane's very strange offside. Chase OPI against Cincy. Once again, sorry guys, I couldn't come up with a better one. It's honestly a pretty weak one for my number five. Number four, Fisher Holding versus Pittsburgh in the 2016 divisional. The KSU double kick versus OU in, I believe, 2020. It might have been 2021. Don't quote my memory on that. Number two, that terrible OPI, roughing the passer, excuse me, on Chris Jones against Tom Brady in the AFC Championship game 2018. And number one, forward progress on a fumble. How do you... Oh, I'm still mad. All right, but that's my list. Allison, what do you got for me?
Okay, all of mine are very recency bias because...
That's fine.
I got like 5 minutes to prep.
Yeah, you had 5 minutes to prep that because I came up with it like on my way up the stairs from the other pod, so...
Oh, man. Okay, so I am going with the, it's not technically a penalty, but one time I've been very upset with NFL ruling was in 2018 against the Patriots in the AFC Championship where we lost the overtime coin toss and Tom Brady got the ball, went down the field, scored a touchdown.
Mm-hmm.
Never got to see the ball in overtime.
Yeah.
All the Chiefs fans complained about it, talked about how it wasn't really a fair representation of the game, even though, yes, our defense should have stopped it, whatever.
Sure.
Exact same thing happened last year with the Bills, and they got a rule change for it.
Yeah. All of a sudden, so, you know.
Okay. But, yeah, that number five, even though it's not technically...
No, I like that. It's completely within the rules, so yeah, keep going. That's good.
Number four, I am also going from this year, K-State versus TCU in the Big 12 Championship where they overturned the safety. It was another big play for me because it ruined a moment. It ruined a momentum shift in the game. We didn't even end up needing those – well, we did need those 2 points because it would have prevented us from going into overtime. However, you can't just take off points on the board like that and then, you know, have the ball given back to that team, that fumble – it was very obviously. I even had KU fans agreeing, like, that was such an obvious safety. What are they doing?
Right. No. His arm was not coming forward. He got the ball slapped out of his hand. How the hell is that not a fumble? Crazy. Crazy.
But number three, I am blanking on who we were even playing. I remember sitting in my living room watching this Chiefs game when Chris Jones got called for roughing the passer once again. Carl Sheffer's squad was out there. Oh, everyone was so mad that Chris Jones got called for
was it
roughing
this
the
season?
Passer on this huge sack. For what?
Was it this season?
Yeah, this season.
Are you talking about the one where Chris Jones was jawing at somebody in the Colts game? And so the Phantom...
No, it wasn't the Colts game. It was when Chris Jones was literally just falling on top of the quarterback.
Oh, the strip sack against Derek Carr. Where he stole
the
ball.
The Raiders. We were playing the Raiders. The entire Arrowhead Stadium was yelling, like...
Oh, my gosh.
You suck, like... Pepper's, his next, like, call sounded like he was crying.
Yeah,
and it
I remember
was, like,
that.
Uncomfortable for everybody. Everyone's, screaming on, you know, social media and whatnot. It wasn't even that, like, we had the game won. It didn't matter. But, like, I've never seen a collective audience that angry at a... officiating crew before. Yeah. And I think that was a compilation of a bunch of, you know, other calls before that, but yeah, that was
rough. Got called for a strip sack when you're getting tackled. Insane.
Yeah.
got called. Yeah. You are getting tackled and you're roughing the passer somehow. Yeah, cool.
I mean, it's calls like that why Chris Jones isn't number one in the league for sacks.
It's true. Oh. It's true.
Number three. Oh, okay. Ooh. This should have been my number five. Super niche one. I swam in high school and I swam club at K-State. I'm into like professional swimming and Olympic swimming. there was a rule change a couple years back, I think after 2012 Olympics. They call it the Lochte rule.
Yeah,
I
heard about this.
Yeah, it's that you can't streamline at any time on your back if you're not swimming backstroke. So in freestyle, you know, you do a flip turn and then you push off the wall. You're always taught to push off the wall on your back because you want to rotate as you're streamlining through the water so you don't get caught up on the wall and take more time. So that first year they implemented DQs across the board because swimmers completely had to change how they swam. And the what they were calling for, there's no consistency on what they're calling it. All of the qualifiers for, you know, world trials and everything got so screwed up. So not happy about that one, but again, super niche.
Hey, no, that's fine. Swimming is really hype, and honestly, people should watch it more.
It's exciting. You just don't do a very good job marketing.
Yeah, and then, you know, you get people like, we have, you know, greats like Katie Ledecky, which is, you know, in our lifetime is going to be what? One of the greatest of all time? Maybe the greatest female swimmer
already
of all time?
Already the greatest, probably.
Yeah, probably already the greatest female swimmer of all time. And we're just not hearing about it as she's dominating. I mean, there's that one picture from this last Olympics where, like, it's like Katie Ledecky is going this way. Every other person in the pool is, you know, 10-plus seconds behind her swimming the opposite way. That's a ridiculous sports photo. This is the Olympics. That kind of stuff doesn't happen. So, no, I'm totally on board with your swimming rule change. That's crazy.
Yep. I don't know. That was four, maybe? Number one, speed travel. You can't – I mean, yes, I'm a K-State fan, but, you know, it is known – it has gone down in history as one of the worst officiating calls in college basketball history. There are memes about it. There are GIFs about it.
Yeah.
Like, it was so bad, and it's one of those games I remember sitting in my friend's basement over winter break, I think it was, like, freshman, sophomore year of college, playing, like, card games in my friend's basement, we were watching the game, and I was like, oh my god, I might actually win this game. And that happened. And I was, like, in disbelief. I was like, oh, they're gonna review that, right?
Right.
They're gonna review it, right? And they just didn't.
Right.
And all the announcers and everyone was like, that's insane. I can't believe they're just calling the game. And I think, you know, it didn't really matter. Like, obviously that was a long time ago, but it's just, it's funny because it's a pop culture thing now. And it's something that, you know, I'll bring up to my KU friends all the time and they bring it up to me and it's just, oh yeah, this is definite proof that you're getting the calls at home
there. Cooking. Yeah, I remember that, because I just remember initially just being frustrated that somehow we allow that layup, you know, at the end. And I was like, oh, man, another K-State choke job. Then I was like, wait a second, he picked up that dribble at half court. Like, how do you swallow the whistle there? This isn't like, you know, you're picking up at the three line and you're taking three big steps, right? I can understand that. Last dribble before half court, you don't... Hey, just, you know, just another long list of grievances as a K-State and Kansas City Chiefs fan. All right, Allison, thank you so much for filling in. You know, wonderful job. Love to have you back on sometime.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, possibly more of the postseason here as we have our Chiefs Super Bowl episode coming up as well. Next week, we are going to be breaking down more Chiefs versus Bengals. We're going to have Hannah Learns to Read back on. Or maybe Home Run Chase for longtime listeners of the show. Both have appeared before. But we're going to meet. Truman's going to be back. And he's got some things to talk about. I'm sure he's got some shit to talk with Bengals fans in general. He's got some grievances to air and some bets to be settled. So thank you guys all for watching. And we're going to get out of here. So from me, I've been Domination, Owen Domination 7 Dom. This has been Allison _ Renner. And thank you guys. We'll see you later. Peace.